And I said, well, that'd be a dream come true. I'd love to release it. And so I walked out to about 2 feet of water, and I flagged that thing out as far as I could and watched it hit the water and go. And I sat there looking at it, just all proud of what I've done. And he yells, get back in here, sometimes they come back on you. And you should see how fast I got to the beach. But it was unreal, I tell you. Some of the experiences I have with God, I love to, I'm kind of a solitary guy down on the beach. I get up, I go to the beach, I'm at the beach from 5:30 to 7:30, and then I'm back on the beach about 10 till 5. And I people say, just lay out the sun and stuff. I swim in the ocean a while. I sit in the chair and read a book for a little bit. I just sit in the chair and watch people for a little bit. Then I take off and go for miles and miles, walks, and then I come back and I pray. One morning I went out all by myself and walked for, I don't know, about a mile and a half and watched the sunrise. It was the most beautiful thing I've ever seen. I sat there praying and crying and talking to God and telling him how much I loved him and what did I do to deserve to get to see all that. And then I turned around and walked back, and he let me be escorted by five dolphins. And the whole trip, they were swimming so slow and playing, the whole trip, I'm walking this way, because it was to my left and way back to the room. I'm walking and watching these dolphins, and they're just coming down and going down. If you haven't seen a dolphin do that, you've truly missed that. It's one of the most beautiful, perfect things I've ever seen in my life. And but we had that. Truly a wonderful time, and it means a lot to me because I put on Facebook today, I put a picture of my dad, and if you see that picture on Facebook today, that is the year that we went to Myrtle Beach to celebrate my surviving leukemia back in 97, and we always went to Father's Day. That was my dad's big thing. We were down there Father's Day. My dad loved to go out on the beach and hang out on the beach all day on Father's Day. And then come in and sit down and we watch the U.S. Open again. And that was probably his favorite day of the year. He just had the family around him. Everybody would sit and watch golf. I mean, the little kids and everything. Nathan and Lewis and watch it. But we would sit and we would watch the U.S. Open. He loved that so much and enjoyed that. And that was just a big part of Father's Day. So I was down there until this, but today I will be watching the U.S. Open. If you would. And, Father's Day is such an important thing. I've been doing some sermon series on scriptures in the Bible, going through texts, but today I stopped because we have some pregnant families in the church. And as I told you, I spoke on Mother's Day about moms because we have some ladies here that are getting close to being moms. And we have some dads that are guys that are going to be dads here real soon. And, dads are very important. You know, everybody has a dad, but a lot of people don't have a dad. There are so many dads missing from people's life. And I got to see some incredible dads at Hillhead. I hope Sammy thought he was with an incredible dad. This is really not yes. Go back to sleep. Anyway. I got to see some incredible dads from dads that, you know, that thing, there's a new thing in society, a lot of older dads never dealt with, but you see the dad with the diaper back with the baby walking into the men's room? Yeah? Everybody see that now? And my dad never did that. I did. Seen one dad that really impressed me. I was telling the Sunday school today. In the last few years, there's been a huge fight to stop it in China. I don't know if you realize it, but babies are born extremely deformed or handicapped. They kill them right there in the burning room because of the overpopulation problems and everything. There's several Christian organizations that are going over to China to save these babies. And people adopt them. And I want you to imagine the families that go out and adopt children with missing a leg and an arm. One little boy had no ears and half his nose was gone. His face was terribly deformed. And his family had adopted three of them. And I tried not to cry. But China and bring them to America and adopt them and all the money that they're spending to raise them. And since you got it, so beautiful. And I watched Dad take these 3 5-year-old boys who, despite their handicaps, were 5-year-old boys into the bathroom. And just amazing. Dads can make such a difference in life. There's a huge difference between good dads and bad dads. And what the scary thing is a dad can define who you are. They found out so much in psychology that people are so affected in their whole life by their relationship with their father. And it's just huge. And you think about it, it's easy to understand because our lives are defined and wrapped around our relationship with our Heavenly Father. Amen? How happy I am in my life, how I live my life, how I act, the things that I pursue are all defined by my relationship with my Heavenly Father. And what happened was I was extremely blessed. It's a huge celebration for me today because I was molded and made into the man I am by a man who was molded by his Heavenly Father. And if my dad were here today to stand and say, he would say, Dan brags on me far too much. He has been molded into the man he is by his Heavenly Father. And that's the first lesson that a good father teaches their children, that as they grow up and as they are being raised, that everything in their lives is about God. And about the relationship with Him. And a good father or a bad dad can affect a relationship with God because we in the church use slang all the time. We use Christian slang, terminology in the Bible that people in the streets don't know. I'm saved by the blood of the Lamb. We realize that people think the PETA people are afraid of us. Right? You go out and say salvation and don't. Very few people know what it is. We throw around this Christian slang. And one of the things that we talk about all the time is our Heavenly Father. And you have to have a relationship with your Heavenly Father. And you get with somebody who their dad was a jerk and didn't take care of them, wasn't there for them. And they say, hey, I have a tough time relating with this father thing. My father wasn't there for me. My father didn't love me. My father was pretty much a jerk. My father didn't want to be around me. My father didn't want to spend any time with me. My father always yelled at me. And you know, what it does is when they hear that, they don't want a relationship with God. Man, I did everything I could to get out of the house and get away from my dad. Why do I want to start a relationship with another man? And that's a weighty thing that comes on fathers. And the fathers have to understand. And that's what we're going to talk about today. Is how to be a good dad. And before we do, go into God's Word. Let's pray. God, we thank you so much. It's such a blessing to celebrate the dads that we've been around. I thank you for my wonderful grandfathers. And I thank you for my wonderful dad, the way he meant to me. And just praise you for the influence that they had in my life. And ask that I will continue to have that influence on my children's life. Lord, I just ask that you would bless us today to all listen to your word and to be the dads that you've called us to be. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, the first thing with dads to start being a good dad is that dads are good husbands. Dads are good husbands. You know, it's God's plan that a couple meets, gets married. You know, you may not like this. God's plan wasn't always that people dated and did all that. Sometimes people were just put together. It was arranged. But people meet each other, get married, and have kids. Now, people get together, have sex, and then they make these, they have meetings. I'm not sure if we're getting married or not. I don't know. I'm having a baby with him. I don't know if I'm going to live with him. Hey, you know, I didn't count my baby coming. I don't know if I want all that responsibility. Right? Are you guys hearing this stuff, or is that just stuff preachers hear? You hear that stuff out in the community, and it's a problem. I talk all the time that the reason these problems are babies having babies because the pressure for sex is so low. But the first thing is that dads are good husbands, and God wants the family. God wants the mom and the dad raising the kid. And that's His plan. That's what He desires. And the thing that a man has to learn is that if he can't devote and love a wife, he is never going to devote and love a child. He's not going to. It's just not going to happen. If a guy can't pay attention to his wife and plan activities and plan things to be together and do all that, he's not going to be with his kids. And selfishness is just unreal today. I can't tell you the amount of counseling I even do in my office with these young couples where a couple get married and in 3 months a wife calls me and says, "How do I get him off of video games?" That's not a joke. It's not a slam on video games. Video games are a lot of fun. I can't imagine somebody not paying attention to their wife because they would rather play video games. I've heard a problem that's not a new thing. I've heard problems with guys who get married and then play golf 7 days a week. I've heard about guys that get married and play softball 7 days a week. Y'all hear these stories? I hear stories about guys that get married and go to work 14 hours a day, Monday through Saturday, and their wives are feeling ignored and they're not feeling loved. And what is happening in that relationship is that the man has not learned how to sacrifice, how to give up things that we enjoy to be with our wives. And if we cannot give up some things that we enjoy doing to be with our wives, we will never be able to give it up to be with our children. We will never be able to find that thing of having a relationship with our child, a friendship that comes with discipline, a different kind of friendship. A friendship with somebody who doesn't always say yes, but makes that tough thing to look down and say no, or look down and say shut up. You know what I mean? All those dad things you have to say sometimes. You know? And it doesn't mean that there's not love there. It's that discipline that we go through. And in 1 Peter 3:7, I love this scripture. Peter says, if you're a husband, you should be thoughtful of your wife. Treat her with honor because she isn't as strong as you are. And she shares with you the gift of life. Then nothing will stand in the way of your prayers. Okay, a couple things I want to do here is I want to talk first about that he says that she isn't as strong as really get offended by this. Well, you have to understand this was written 2,000 years ago, and a lot of the part of life was having to do what? Lift things. Do you understand the conveniences that we have today? And I'm going to tell you, I saw these two girls fighting when this began last night. I think that it would change the scripture if I was married to either one of them, because it would have to say, you know, the husband isn't as strong as the wife. These girls have big guns, you know? And they're kicking each other in the face, punching each other. I don't know. But anyway, back in these days, that didn't happen. And the women weren't as strong as the men, so please don't think that's an anti-sexist thing. But there are three commands that come to this. Number one is to be thoughtful of your wife. To be thoughtful. Think about her. Think about your wife. What is she going to do? What is your day going to be like? How is she living? Be thoughtful of her. Think about her. And then number two, it says to treat her with honor. You know, to kind of raise her up on a table and tell everybody how great she is. And that is what God expects us to do in marriage. And when we do that, we learn to do that with our children. Because we make those sacrifices and we take care of our wives and we honor them, then we will honor our children. You know, and third, nothing will stand in the way of your prayers, because a good man, good dads pray. Good dads pray. I knew how much my dad prayed for me. I knew how much my grandfather prayed for me. And my my children know how much I pray for them. Hannah cracks me up. I'll be walking down the beach, and I take my phone with me, and everybody says, don't answer your phone, you're on vacation. Well, first of all, y'all know you can't do that. Second of all, it's my camera. Okay, and I don't know when I'm going to need a picture, so I'm walking on the phone, and it's Hannah. Dad, I need you to pray about this. Dad, a customer just came into Starbucks and told me about this. I need you to pray about this. Dad, I need you to pray for my friend. She came in today and she's crying. This happened to her about her college loans and all this stuff, and I need you to pray for her. My daughter calls me with 7 to 10 prayer requests today. You know, that's incredible. I'm so proud of that. I know what her prayer life's like. And I hope it's good that she knows her values. Because she saw that growing up. And she knows how important it is. Because when anything happens, you take it to that. Amen. Kids learn that. You know why the kids aren't praying today? Because they're not seeing their dads pray. And if you have prayer meetings, the attendance of women to men at prayer meetings is embarrassing. And I'm going to tell you that straight up front. The men in the United States of America who go to meeting places and complain about the government and complain about if they're going to take our guns and complain about this and complain about this are not on their knees. And you know what God says right here? He says, in a marriage, nothing will stand in the way of your prayers. If you're treating your wife bad, it's going to mess up your prayer life, and you should have a serious prayer life. Amen? Boy, I got kind of preaching there. I must have been on the beach. Good dads lead by example. Their children will watch them and see how they are. Our second point today is that dads are good dads. It sounds stupid, but it makes sense when you listen. You strive to be a good dad. When that baby comes out, is the first thing you say is, boy, God, thank you for this loner. Because you let me have this. This isn't mine. This is yours. And my job is to bring this up for you, so that it imitates you and knows you and loves you and understands who you are. You are giving me this responsibility. And if I do that, I need to be a good dad. I need to be like you. Luke 11:9-13, God says this, so I tell you to ask and you will receive. Search and you will find. Knock and the door will be open for you. Everyone who asks will receive. Everyone who searches will find. And the door will be open for everyone who knocks. Which one of you fathers would give your hungry child a snake if the child asks for a fish? Which one of you would give your child a scorpion if the child asks for an egg? As bad as you are, you still know how to give good gifts to your children. But your heavenly Father is even more ready to give the Holy Spirit to anyone who asks. You know, we're bad. We're sinners. You know, it's part of what we have to realize. We have to come to the realization that we're sinners. I preached in the hot tub the other day. And I'm talking to all these medical school students from Cleveland, and they're in a hot tub, and they're talking and really enjoying my visit with them. And they come to that question, what do you do for a living? I said, what do you think I do for a living? Well, are you a businessman? Are you a pro golfer? I said, I'm a Baptist minister. No way. I think the tub became holy water. And I started talking to them about their Heavenly Father and how much He loves them and the misconcept and the way that people perceive even me just because I'm a minister. That they don't know. But even though that I am that, I know I'm a sinner. And I was teaching them that we're all sinners. We all are far from God. But you know what? The thing is that He forgives us and brings us close. But you know, He says as terrible as we are, we're good dads. We should be thinking about our kids. And so we have to strive to be good dads. And do you take care of your kids? You know where your kids are? Is it the wife's job? If it's the wife's job, you fail it already. It's dad's job as much as it is the wife's kids. My wife told me I had to take care of the kids for a little while. I want to grab young dads when they say that smack them. My wife said I have to take care of the kids for a while. Oh, wow, you're a great guy. That's incredible. You're actually going to be responsible for what God gave you to take care of for just a little bit. Do we meet their needs? Do we meet our children's needs? I'm not talking about the amount of video games they have, but are we teaching them about God? Fathers from all over America are walking away from the kids. They don't want to be with them. They have no responsibility. And it makes me think of what if God walked away from us. What would we think if our Heavenly Father walked away from us? It's vacation time. And, you know, summertime, church attendance always be a thing. And you know it's coming. People say, well, should I go to church on vacation? Well, it's up to you. I don't always go to church on vacation. Sometimes I have my Bible, and I'm on my knees, and I'm on the beach, and I'm going to tell you, it don't get any better than that is where I like to go worship. I miss the people. Because the church is dealing with the people to worship, and I miss that. But I know that I will be with God. And I think about how many people that take like the whole summer off, and I'm thinking, what if God took the whole summer off? Did you think about that? What if you got on your knees to pray and God said, I'm on vacation, man. Remember what we had to deal with you, that cancer scare back in December? Remember that? Huh? Remember how I was there for you? You were crying every night and all that? I need a summer away from you. As a matter of fact, a few of the angels told me, Dad, you need to just turn your cell phone off. You need to take a break. I'm sorry, it's really gross when you sniff the microphone. But God does it. And real dads don't take time off for their kids. Maybe dad 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, praying for their children, loving their children, and ready to be there in a heartbeat to take care of what they need. Good dads imitate God. A good dad imitates God. You see, God is our Heavenly Father. And he watches over us and he loves us so much. He lets us go through things. Once you start bailing your kids out of everything, you're not being a good dad. Do we go through some stuff? Yeah, God lets us go through stuff. But tell us, hey, you went through it. I was there with you. The New Testament is full of the word perseverance. Nobody likes that. Because God is with us as we persevere, as we go through things. It is just part of life. It's part of our relationship with him. But he is always there with us, always loving us, and we need to be like him. Ephesians 5:1, the CEV, I love how it says, do as God does, after all you are his dear children. Now you might know that letter as imitate. Be ye therefore imitators of God. Be as God is. You want to be a good dad? Act like God. That is the way to be a good dad. Do what he does. Because what kind of God is a dad? If you want a perfect explanation of what kind of dad God is, all you have to do is read Luke 15:11-32. Jesus also told them another story. Once a man had two sons. The younger son said to his father, give me my share of the property. So the father divided his property between his two sons. Not long after that, the son packed up everything he owned and left for a foreign country, where he wasted all his money in wild living. He had spent everything when a bad famine spread through that whole land, and soon he had nothing to eat. He went to work for a man in that country, and the man sent him out to take care of his pigs. He would have been glad to eat what the pigs were eating, but no one gave him a thing. Finally, he came to his senses and said, my father's workers have plenty to eat, and here I am starving to death. I will go to my father and say to him, Father, I have sinned against God in heaven and against you. I am no longer good enough to be called your son. Treat me like one of your workers. The younger son got up and back to his father. But when he was still a long way off, his father saw him and felt sorry for him. He ran to his son and hugged and kissed him. The son said, Father, I have sinned against God in heaven and against you. I am no longer good enough to be called your son. But his father said to the servants, hurry and bring the best clothes and put them on him. Give him a ring on his finger and sandals for his feet. Get the best calf and prepare it so we can eat and celebrate. This son of mine was dead but has now come back to life. He's lost and has now been found. And they began to celebrate. The older son has been out in the field. When he came near the house, he heard the music and dancing. So he called one of the servants over and asked, what's going on here? The servant answered, your brother has come home safe and sound, and your father has ordered us to kill the best calf. The older brother got so angry that he would not even go into the house. His father came up, begged him to come in, and he said to his father, for years I have worked like a slave for you, and I have always obeyed you, but you have never given me even a little goat so that I can get dinner for my friends. This other son of yours waste your money on prostitutes, and now that he's come home, you ordered the best calf to be killed for a feast. His father replied, my son, you are always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we should be glad and celebrate. Your brother was dead, and he is now alive. He was lost and has now been found. This is the story of God. It's the Father in the story is God. It's not Jesus. He's telling the story of his heavenly Father. It is God. And we see some traits here of God that we can learn. Number one, he is loving. He's loving enough that he actually gave his son his inheritance. He gives us this world. All the things that we have in it. All the beauty and wonderful to do with the wind. That kid squandered his money. You know, I see people throw trash down in the ocean. How in the world does somebody live with themselves throwing trash in the ocean in the mountains? It's so beautiful. How does anybody do that? It's just like this guy squandered wealth. We squander the world. We squander all of God's good gifts. He's so loving. He gives us these things. He is an incredible trader. Because you know what? When the son goes off, he remembers what his dad was like. He remembers all the things that his dad taught him. He has a good reputation. People know who he is. They know what his reputation is, what he stands for. He is forgiving. When his son comes back, he is forgiving. He is a great provider. A great provider. He says, give him a ring and sandals. Get the best calf to do that. Because he loves him so much, he wants him to know everything that he has for him. He is an incredible teacher. And we said traitor, but notice he had a teacher because when his son is so bad and he's doing all that for his evil brother, what's he out there doing? He's teaching him to love. You know, I wonder about dads teaching love. I get a lot of counseling sessions with dads who don't say I love you to their wives or their kids. And I'm going to tell you a lie from Satan. I want you to write this down. Here's one of Satan's biggest lies. You don't have to tell people you love them. You can show it to them. That is the devil. He is a liar. I want you to read through your Bible, and I want you to see how many times God tells you that he loves you. And I want you to see how many times that Jesus Christ tells you that he loves you. If you want to know how many times that I see these young girls living promiscuous lives, sleeping with 23, 24 different guys, getting sexual diseases, going off into all this stuff, and when you sit down and talk with them, they say, my dad never once said, I love you. Never once said, I love you. I would like to know today, is it that hard? Is it that hard to tell people, I love you? Because as we imitate God, he has no problem saying, I love you. I was really tired a few weeks ago and called Pizza Hut. And when the order finished, the lady said, we'll have that ready, Pastor. And I said, thanks, I love you. And she said, well, we think you're nice too. I said, oh, I didn't even embarrass him. I said, I know you guys, so I just think I've got